Hey there, look what I've got here. My new printer, an Elegoo Neptune X. Today I'm going to show you how to assemble it, doing some first prints and discuss the pros and cons of this printer and if you should get one for yourself. My name is Tom and you're watching 3D Printing Geek. The Elegoo Neptune X was rarely available when it came out last year in September at a suggested price of about $400 US. Fortunately, the price has dropped since so that you can get this printer nowadays for about $240 US from some sellers.
A cursory glance would suggest that this is a CoXY printer. Unfortunately, Elegoo missed the opportunity. The Neptune X is a Creality Ender 5 Pro clone. The technical specs are very similar to other Cartesian printers in the price range below $400. When I assembled the printer, I stumbled over a very dangerous issue, which may be the same for most of Chinese printers. Keep watching to see what it is and how you can fix it.
So let's open the package. There's some protective foam, which we don't need anymore. A printed manual with build instructions in it and instructions how to operate the printer.
After getting everything out of the packet, we have the following parts: the heat bed with a flexible print plate, some bags with screws, tools and a spool holder, the four columns which holds the structure of the printer together, the printer's base with a touch screen to operate it. Then there's the top mount with the gantries to hold the carriages for X and Y, an extruder, a power cord, and finally we have the Z-axis mount and the manual for the printer.
Assembling the printer should be straightforward, but first a short ad from this video's sponsor, which is PCBWay. PCBWay is an industry-leading manufacturer of PCBs, providing high-quality PCBs at a low price, making it your one-stop manufacturer regardless if you're a DIY maker, a growing startup or a settled company. Make sure to check out PCBWay for your next project.
Before starting the assembly, let's have a closer look inside to see the controller board, just to make sure everything's wired up and connected correctly. All wires are crimped and screwed to the terminals of the power supply, and it's very good to see that there's a correct ground earth connected to the chassis of the printer's board so that it can be operated securely. The plugs going to the control board are secured with some glue stick, which I think is a little bit weird, but it keeps the connections from getting loose. It's obscure that they also use glue stick on the screw terminals connecting the power to the control board. I need to check if these are crimped as well, because if not, this can be a security risk. The cables can heat up and cause fire. So I peel the glue stick away and pull one of the cables out to see if Elegoo did their job well. I feared that no wire and ferrule, and even worse, the strands are soldered together. That's a potential risk. These are the points where the cable gets hot and the terminal blocks may melt or even catch fire. So let's fix this by crimping the cable ends properly. Cut the cable end to remove the soldered part. Then remove the insulation from the cable end, put a ferrule on it and crimp it tight to the end. That is the correct way to do it. Now I put it back into the terminal and make sure that the screw is fastened tight, and I will repeat it for the remaining cables.
Bags with screws and cable ties. Tools for the assembly. Then we have a scrapie. And this is what I really like. We have a USB stick, because the Elegoo Neptune has a USB port instead of a micro SD card slot. That's really nice. I like that. A USB cable to connect the printer to your PC or laptop, or maybe to your Raspberry Pi if you're running it with OctoPi. A flat cutter. And finally, a needle to clean up your nozzle from a jam.
When mounting the columns, take care that the screw holes in the side of the columns have to face to the left and right outside of the base and at the far end of it. Screw them to the base and tighten them. Take care to have the column ends flush with the bottom profile when locking the screws. Next, the top responsible for the XY motion of the printhead is mounted on the top of the columns. Place it to match the screw holes in the columns and use the 5x25 screws to fasten it. The 4x16 screws are used to fix the top to the columns from the sides. If the wheels of the carriages running in the slots have not enough grip, use the wrench to turn the eccentric nut a little bit. Now take the pre-assembled Z-axis, position it and use the 5x20 screws to lock it in place. Using the 4x8 screws, fix the build platform to the Z-axis kit. Remove the foil covering the belt tightener and unscrew it. Turn it around by 180 degrees and install it back. If the belt got loose, like in my case, you have to put the end of the belt into the slot of the carriage. Then turn the knob to tighten the belt a little bit. Mount the E-stepper about 4 cm away from the top of the back left column. Then push the PTFE tube down all the way into the extruder and fix it with the clip. Again, we have a very simple spool holder. I think I'm going to replace it very soon with a better one, like the one I showed in my video about reducing friction to print faster. Just put it some centimeter from the bottom of the back left column where the E-stepper is. Thanks to the labeling of the cables, it is very easy to connect them correctly. Plug in filament runout sensor and E-stepper. Plug together all the matching cables at the base of the printer. And continue until you made all the connections. Time to get ready for the first test print. Plug in the power cord and switch the printer on. After quick boot, the LCD menu shows up. Before doing the first print, the bed needs to be leveled. Touch the tools menu, then home, and there all to move all stepper motors to their end stop positions. Tighten the nuts below the build plate to lower the platform so that the printhead's nozzle has some clearance. Use the touch buttons to move the printhead to each corner and the center. Use a piece of paper at each position and adjust the knobs until you feel some friction between the nozzle and the bed. I suggest repeating this process once again, since turning one knob affects the position of the other corners a little bit. For the first print, I used the pre-sliced G-code in the root of the thumb drive because this is the manufacturer's chance to showcase the printer's quality using optimized slicer settings. As you can see, it came out perfect. I also checked the advertised resume after power failure function, but since the print bed had cooled down, the model was kicked from the bed, so this is not that useful. Resuming the print after the filament runout sensor had been triggered and putting in new filament into the printer, on the other hand, worked exceptionally well, as you can see here. The lines where the print resumed are hardly to spot and almost not visible. I wanted to see how the printer performs printing TPU and what can be best used to check the printer's capabilities than printing a Benchy. So I used my common TPU profile settings and started to print one. And as you can see, it's nice, squashy and has a little bit of stringing, but that's okay. The surface finish, the rooftop and even the chimney look great. And it's fun to squeeze it and see how it gets back into shape. I had laying around a spool of co-extrusion filament in the colors gold silver and had never printed a model with it, so I decided to print this nice dragon.
The color change effect when you turn it in the light is amazing. For the last print I wanted something really big. So I downloaded this model of the Eiffel Tower and scaled it up so that it almost used the whole build platform. I glued together the two parts and got this amazing model of the Eiffel Tower with a height of about 45 centimeters. Taking a look at the models, I'm very satisfied how they all came out, and this printer may be my new favorite one.
I printed the Kickstarter Autodesk printer test to see how it compares to other printers.
After doing the measurements in all 7 categories of the test, I got a final score of 25.5. I found a review on the website R3DP of the Creality Ender 5 Pro, where they did the Kickstarter Autodesk test as well, and so I'm able to compare my score with theirs. For the Creality Ender 5 Pro, their score was 20. So if in doubt and if you can get your hands on Elegoo Neptune X, I would say it is a better choice than the Creality Ender 5 Pro.
If you enjoyed the video, please boop the like button and subscribe to my channel.